This is the Budget and Finance Committee meeting, Wednesday, September 26, 2012, and this is the call to order. The next business is approval of the committee minutes for August.
Move for approval.
Second.
Comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Item three is consideration of the ordinance 2012-50, which will be the budget amendments for the fourth quarter of actually fiscal year 2012.
What you'll find in your handouts is that you will actually find the budget amendments for the fourth quarter, as well as the fiscal year end 2012 budget report. And only one of these requires action, but I'd like to maybe go through the budget amendments. If you will look, you'll notice that for the general fund, we are not proposing any new budget amendments, but you'll notice we are talking about reallocations, because when you look at the general fund, it had $53 million budgeted, but yet, due to cost containment measures, only $50 million was spent. So in essence, we're well within the amount budgeted. Well, the one thing we try to do with expenditures within the department is actually charge it to the correct department, even if it was not originally identified. So essentially, if you'll look over at the budget report, and I believe it's on page 3, you'll actually see there's some reallocations, because one good example is in BNS, Building and Neighborhood Services, where in essence, because of the hazard mitigation program, they actually had some expenditures that they weren't necessarily identified to begin with, as well as there were some departments that actually had expenses, like in the general expense department, that essentially had $250,000 budgeted for the mid-year raises. So essentially what we've done is we've essentially provided a reallocation that would basically let every department be within budget.
Essentially.
Essentially, yes, essentially within budget, yes.
Sorry, couldn't help it.
And so then I guess there is a budget amendment we're requesting in the solid waste fund.
Right, I was going to say.
Because I guess what we have is, especially in the disposal division, there were some fuel costs as well as some repair costs, and that kind of came to $125,000. And at the same time, we also had less tipping fee revenue. So if you take both those items together, there's actually a transfer needed from the general fund of $400,000. And in the general fund, that's included within the reallocations.
Why are tipping fees less?
I think what it is, it actually turned out they were the same as last year, but a lot of times when we do the budget, we sometimes will anticipate an increase, and essentially the increase didn't occur.
So is that from our internal tipping fees that we saw the decrease?
At the transfer station, essentially when persons, or I guess when entities go across the transfer station, essentially that's what those are.
Right, but I'm just saying the way we restructured everything, that we're not hauling our own waste.
I don't think it has to do with this.
This is on
incoming. Exactly.
These are third-party contractors that are going elsewhere. Mm-hmm. If you remember, year before last, we included we raised the fee at the tipping station and included a surcharge for fuel because our fuel costs were going up substantially. And that did drive off some business. But with the math that we were working with, we were approaching the point of losing money on each ton that we took in. So that did change both the revenue and the expense side.
And the third bullet point is
talking. I also noticed police had additions for two quarters, but then the fourth quarter, it looks like they had a subtraction, so.
Exactly, yeah. In the report, what we try to do is actually track the activity. So in essence, with this being the fourth quarter budget amendments, it actually shows you the amendments from the first, second, and the third quarters as well.
So what happened here? Did you place the 250? What happened here?
What it is, they actually, those were lease expenses they had budgeted, and because the cars came in later in the year, in essence, their lease expenses were less than what we had anticipated.
Okay. Do we want to continue to talk about the amendments, or I could ask a few questions on the...
While we're on police, how many understaffed do we have in police? or whatever you call those positions.
Vacancies.
Unfunded, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's around 24 total vacancies.
Okay. Thank you.
And we did add back a couple in this budget. Of previously unfunded vacancies, we did go ahead and fill to help, especially with controlling overtime overall. So, and that kept us in line, too, with a staffing of about one sworn officer per 2,000 population. Or two officers per 1,000 population, let me say that one.
Probably sounds right.
Yeah, said the wrong.
Yeah.
Flip it.
Well, can we go ahead and let him finish this and then come back?
Well, if we could, that would be great.
I would, you might do that.
These are actually together.
The next item, if you look, what we had is we have an amendment in the debt service fund as well as the road impact fund. And this is what we had discussed with this committee as well as bond council and the city's auditors. Because what we did is we had been tracking the fund balance in the debt service fund, and it was essentially $1.3 million at the end of the year. And this is because of rebates that we got from recovery funds as well as variable interest rates. So in essence, what it is, we were thinking what could be the potential use for that fund balance. We knew the road impact fund had a $2.2 million deficit. So what we're proposing in these amendments is essentially to reduce that deficit from $2.2 million down to $1.2 million with this $1 million, essentially not doing that transfer to reduce that deficit. And the reason we're leaving $300,000 in the debt service fund is because with the refunding we're getting ready to do, we're going to be changing from variable interest to fixed interest. Mm-hmm. So we wanted to make sure there were funds to basically take care of that, because we knew it was not in the budget that was just approved. And the last item, I guess, that we have is in the capital projects fund. Right now, there is only monies for the public works building. That's the only thing, if you look back at the budget amendments that we put in there at this point. So we now know what those total expenses are. So what we're also asking is that we be able to add $12.5 million of expenses to the capital projects fund to cover the expenses for the year. So in essence, that would cover not only the public works building, but also cover expenses for Lake McEwen, for Matt Hatcher, for Hillsboro Road. In these essence, that's
for
the,
this year's.
For these are all year. Projects that yeah. you've previously yes. approved.
Yeah. Exactly.
And the expenditures occurred mm-hmm. in fiscal 12.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, we need to. That's mm-hmm. one of the things we need to talk a little bit more about, because mm-hmm. you know, I didn't find them in the budget, mm-hmm. and then I was glad to see that we had the prior year there. But I'd really like mm-hmm. to see about 5 years on that, because I don't really recall that as being a part of the budgeting process. I know it's different. Mm-hmm. I know it's different from the other thing, but still, it would be helpful to see, kind of to track mm-hmm. maybe 5 years on that mm-hmm. To yeah. see what's going on.
Yeah. And also, with this fund, the state requires us to budget the general fund, special revenue funds, and the debt service funds. So basically, it doesn't require us necessarily to have a budget on the front end on this one. Right. But I guess because of practice, we always try to have a budget by year end.
And I do want to. But again, it wasn't included in the budget exactly. fiscal year 13.
Exactly.
So, as yeah. I say, it'd be of interest, I think, for us to look at maybe mm-hmm. 5 year history on that.
Exactly. And also, what we'll do is maybe as early as the next committee, we'll provide you a bond use summary. It's probably been a few months since we've had updated it, and we thought that we could basically let you see the activity that's been out of that fund. And all of these items are on the ordinance that is attached. Mm-hmm. I would like to maybe ask that one small typo be corrected. Mm-hmm. If you look on it where it says $12.5 million, you'll notice when it's listed a second time, it says $12 million. So we would just like that before it goes to the board, if it could be changed to be $12.5 million right. in both spots.
Right here?
On the very bottom.
Yes,
on
the very bottom.
Two?
On the very bottom.
Oh, I
bottom.
See.
First
yeah.
page.
Five.
Yeah.
So I knew that we could get it updated, but I just wanted to make mention of it. And I knew that was really all the information, I guess, that maybe what we might be asking is for a recommendation to the board to be able to take these fourth quarter amendments to the Board of Mayor and Aldermen.
And all of this plays into the information that we give to our auditor, so we're probably
exactly.
good to go
That's
on
it.
Get that to the
Board of Mayor and Alderman.
Okay, I move that we adopt these amendments and move them on to the Board of Mayor and Alderman.
Second.
And also change the notation for the last number on page, on the first page of the document to, under net increase, decrease to capital project fund balance from 12 million to 12,500,000.
I'll second that.
Is there any other comment about the ordinance? Okay.
That's pretty good.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, none. Before we leave, though, this on the City of Franklin, I think on page two, there is also a typo there. Wait just a minute. That may not be where it is. Oh, yeah. On the facilities tax, it says the decrease is 636%. I don't think that's right, because it was a negative and it became...
Yeah.
It became positive.
Yes, it should be a positive, yes. Okay. It was probably a formula, and I apologize that it didn't get caught.
Right.
Because facilities tax is one of those funds that actually has gone from a deficit fund balance to a surplus balance of 1.5 million.
And back, what, a couple of years ago, it was a deficit of 3 million. Yes. So we definitely have come a long way on that.
I don't know how you do a percentage increase off of a negative
number.
Off a
negative, I don't know.
Yes.
And
I think that's what it is. Anytime you have it where it's going in different directions, sometimes it's kind of difficult to tell on the face of it.
Well, the formula has that negative number.
Exactly. Exactly.
Anyway, okay.
Okay.
We'll try to fix that.
Okay. And on page eight, now this is where I think that on the facilities tax fund that we were just speaking of, I think on the total unallocated funds in the prior year, that is a minus, isn't it?
Yes.
291,165. That should be a negative.
Oh, I see.
Which, this
I
very see. Negative we're I talking see. About, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Think.
Just to highlight, and I was a little late coming out of another meeting, but the overall performance in the general fund in terms of a $1.2 million revenue over expenditures is significant. First time in several years we've had that.
Right.
Brings our general fund balance up to over $26 million, $26.15 million, which again is a high point from the last several years. And so that's a real compliment to our ability to control expenditures. And when we were talking about this with our leadership team the other day, our staff leadership team, Russ pointed out that that's a $1.2 million surplus at the end of the year. All the while, we absorbed about a $300,000 greater than expected fuel cost, because fuel costs spiked and went much higher than we had budgeted for. Uh-huh. So, in that we were able to absorb that and still come out very positive. So, my compliments really to our department leadership and everybody throughout the organization who just worked hard to live within the means and be careful about the dollars we spend, and I think that's a real compliment to the stewardship we have in our departments. So I just felt we needed to highlight that. That is no small accomplishment.
I agree.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. On page 14, when it has the debt service fund, it has bond proceeds put into the debt service fund. I wasn't sure why that would. It's in the prior year, it says, but I wasn't quite sure what that went into.
What that is? That is when there's a refunding. It actually shows up in revenue as well as expenses. So in essence, that's essentially a one-time transaction. But that is how come it's in there, because it affects the fund balance. But essentially, it was a refunding.
Okay.
That's actually why
you paid it back out again.
Exactly. That's why you'll notice the debt service expenditures are much higher than typical.
Is that reflective of the water that we refunded last year, or which?
Let me see. No, one of it was the Battlefield Park, wasn't it, or Harlandsdale? Harlandsdale was a big part of it. I think.
Oh, it is
well,
a
wait,
prior
that
year.
May not
I'm
be
sorry,
right.
It's a prior year, so it would
it's
be.
It is.
if you'll look, it's actually down here at the very bottom where it says 2010 new bonds. It was used to refund the 2005 Tennessee loans and the Harlansdale bonds. So that is that 16.59 million. That is it. It did occur during that this year.
Okay. On page 16, on the water sewer fund, because we're going to be talking about water sewer, it's in here that the stone revenues contribution from developer, is this one of those where they get this paid back to them in the case of, I guess it's whenever fees are paid, is this rebated back to the developer?
You're talking about the sewer offsets?
I guess it's a sewer offset. I don't know. It just says contributions from developer, and I wondered, is this something that's to be offset?
Actually, the one thing about the water sewer fund is when we get to fiscal year end, we actually have to change it from looking like a governmental fund to actually looking like a private sector. And what this is actually donated assets to the water sewer department from developments. So in essence, it wasn't necessarily cash.
So we accepted
it's the value the of the accepted assets.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So although streets are like that too, but we don't count them this way because it's not a proprietary fund.
So if they put in sewer pipe or something like that in a subdivision, it's counted as a donated.
Exactly. Yeah. That's exactly how it's handled.
But it's not what they get. It's not what they do above and beyond what's required for their development. Where they get the forgiveness.
The offsets.
Okay. That's, it says water purchase was 13.5% lower than last year. Is that because
people saving water?
No, I just wondered if it was because we had all the rain in the we didn't have rain in June, did we?
Well, we would have, compared to prior year, we would have had the reservoir.
Yeah, we did. Oh, maybe the reservoir.
And the reservoir would have been off on at least a portion of the prior.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes.
Plus, we did have rain in June.
Nah, that June was the hot month.
Early on.
This year.
Yeah. It's the rest of the summer that we've had rain. I mean, everything's still green, which is amazing for here.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Good. Okay. Anybody else have anything on the just that quarterly report? And those really went together, didn't they? Yeah. So are we ready to go to item number four?
I would point out that this is on the website now.
Yep. It is.
For any of our audience to look at the details.
Yeah. Okay. And these amounts are unaudited. The auditors will actually be back in November with the actual audited numbers.
Right. The only thing I would ask is for the capital projects fund, I'd just like to look at the history maybe for 5 years or something on that. Okay, item number four is the request for additional personnel within the Building and Neighborhood Services to support the increased inspection services demand.
We had talked about this with the full board and had asked that this come back through the Budget and Finance Committee for some discussion. This is reflective of an increased workload and the demands that we're facing and trying to be responsive to those and how we might adjust our personnel budget to reflect the demands that we have to still meet the expectations of our customers. And Chris has done a lot of detailed work to summarize the workload that we have compared to other communities and other standards that you might look at in this field. And I'll let him kind of take you through that.
Well, sure.
Answer any questions you have from that.
Sure. Over the last 6 years, we have, with the downturn in the economy and downturn in construction, we have drawn down our staff through reorganization and attrition to roughly half what we had at the peak. And as the construction has picked back up, we're starting to see the number of inspections that we saw during those times. And we have compared our workloads via benchmarks for communities around the nation, and right now we're doing approximately twice as much as the communities that participated in the benchmarking study. The vast majority of them, there's only one more community that has done that has a workload of more than ours per inspector, and it's only by a very trivial amount. So so we've got the volume of inspections that has increased since we did the budget that has we have basically met this load by utilizing our supervisors, by utilizing our plans examiners, by utilizing the building official, myself, and other certified personnel throughout the department to meet these. You know, we're not able to meet it with just the inspectors we have on staff. We have to use everybody we've got when those inspections come in, and you know, their jobs are, you know, they also play a vital role in the function of our department, primarily in dealing with customer service issues and making sure that we have that we deal with problems, we deal with customers on an individual basis, that we are proactive in handling quality control and making sure that we give the high level of service that Franklin citizens demand and deserve. We have also seen an increase in revenue over the last calendar year that that would justify putting these positions in there. We've got, you know, the money we're taking in would cover the increase that we're asking for. And really what we're asking for is to convert two part-time positions into two full-time positions to, you know, for the inspection positions, and then also to hire an administrative assistant. In previous years, we had parceled out all the administrative tasks, time clock, purchasing, meeting records requests, any number of administrative type functions amongst the supervisors during times when we didn't have as much workload. And now that we've got the workload back, we need to push those items back onto an administrative assistant so that we can free up the senior staff to tackle the their essential functions.
But they stick with that, does seniors, those also take over, you know, and do some inspections still if needed?
Well, sure. You know, they're with this addition of personnel, we're kind of, you know, we're still going to lag the trend. We're going to stay behind what we could ask for in order, you know, we don't know if it's going to drop back off again or go back up. You know, it's a little bit uncertain. So we're kind of asking for a little bit of what we need, and we're still going to utilize the senior building inspectors. I estimate about half the time that we were using them, and then see what happens with the next budget year before we come back and ask for additional personnel, so that we're sure we're not over hiring.
And it looks as if probably they would be, maybe these new hires would be in, you know, be on the job, say, for half of the fiscal year. Is that, what it looks like, or maybe a little bit more?
We've got
a little bit more, we estimated.
Yes.
When do you want to bring them in?
8 months, I think, maybe. Yeah. We can look at the numbers.
Well, they're already in, from what I understand. I mean, there's wisdom in the fact that you're growing within because you're cutting down on your training because they've already been working for us part-time.
Correct.
So that's the beauty of the deal, you know? Correct?
Well, we would have two full-time positions that we would post. We have part-time employees now that are providing inspection services. They'd have to apply and go through the process. But there's an advantage for folks that are already working with us to compete for those jobs, but we would have to go through a full posting.
Sure.
How is this term different? It's the same job.
Okay. We can't just say, hey, you've been, like, this doesn't work that way. Just
we have a policy of making our positions open and available. Sometimes we post only internally if it's a specialized job. Sometimes we post both internally and externally. And mm-hmm. that would be a judgment call for Chris to make in deciding how to post it.
So then why do we even suggest that we want to put part-time people as full-time? Just the position as well?
We're talking about the position being converted from a part-time. So from a budgetary standpoint, you've already budgeted a portion of the cost mm-hmm. of the position. You're upgrading it to a full-time, which gives us the additional hours to help with the inspection.
And those people may not even, you may have somebody that doesn't even want to work full-time.
Sure.
So they may not apply for it.
You know, for example, the part-time electrical inspector we have, he can work 1 or 2 days a week is all he, you know, he also works for the state doing electrical inspections. So he can't, although we've we can use him for up to 1,500 hours. Realistically, we only get him 1 or 2 days a week. And it's hard to find somebody with those qualifications willing to work part-time, so we're really glad to have those guys.
So would that eliminate his job if we're not budgeting for a part-time position?
Well, he, in that particular case, he stated he would be willing to apply for the job and would love to come to work for Franklin as opposed to the state.
I feel like we're so cumbersome. Everything would make it harder than it has to be.
It's
cumbersome.
The way government works.
I'm getting used to government.
It's the openness and of the process that we need to provide. And we are fortunate we have some good people that will compete very well for the jobs.
Make it fair and open.
I really appreciate the position that you're in because, you know, yes, your people can speed up, make their commitments, and get things covered, but there's always that chance that you've overlooked something because you've gone through it too quickly. And secondarily, since supervisors are also filling in that ought to be doing the monitoring of consistency of the work of the field inspectors, then that often gets lost, and then again, mistakes can occur. So I agree that this is needed, and I fully support it.
And we think that the increased revenue will pay for themselves, really.
Yes, and really more than offset those costs from what we're projecting. I guess the question for this committee is how you'd like to handle it. We're just finishing the first quarter, and we've established a pattern of doing quarterly budget amendments. We could fold this into the first quarter budget amendments if you are comfortable with that mechanism, or we could do a direct action authorizing this change, and we'd still need to capture it in a budget amendment at some point. So however you would like to proceed, if and what normally happens is the amendments come through you to the full board. And that's probably the easiest way, smoothest way to do it is just incorporate it that way. We can go ahead with your blessing, start the process, and you know, have that amendment done before we hire the positions.
Yeah. Does either way have negative effects on how soon we'll get the personnel in?
I don't think, I think the amendment's probably the quickest way to do it. That's why I'm suggesting that, if we can expedite that through.
But it's really not going to be in this quarter, though. It's not going to be.
No, it's really not.
It's really not.
That's true, it's really not.
But you're starting.
You could authorize it in this quarter, projecting the cost that we gave you for the balance of the year, which is around an 8-month cost, and it would be an adjustment. We'd do it on both sides of the equation. We'd increase our revenue estimate, and we'd increase this as a projected expenditure for 8 months of the positions that we've asked for.
But it really won't be technically a first quarter amendment.
Yeah,
it would.
Yeah, you're not incurring the cost in the first quarter, but you will have made a decision that authorizes the expenditure for the balance of the year. It's more of a prospective amendment than a retro. Active one, which is normally what happens. Normally, something has already happened and we're adjusting for it, as opposed to we're making this adjustment in the budget going forward, if that
and
makes
that's,
sense.
And that's not unusual. All of your, if a special project comes up, we'll
that's
go
true.
Ahead and amend the budget, even though it may be 6 months before we spend the money. The point in doing the budget amendment is so when we give our departments their financial reports, that the new budgeted amount is showing up in all of their reports, and we're measuring against them against that.
But technically, it won't be at the end of the. What I'm trying to say is, even if we suggest that, the board will not act on it until the second quarter has already started.
Correct.
Right. It would be sometime during the second quarter, probably.
I don't know that it matters.
October, early November, I guess.
Last year we did it in November.
So. Probably hit the board schedule in November.
And that might be the right timing too, you know, perhaps. You know. As I say, I don't have any strong feelings either way.
Okay.
First of all, I guess we need to say we need to
I'd like an action of the committee that gives us at least enough direction.
Let's go ahead that we work on this right here, saying that we would support or recommend to the board the additional personnel
budget
staffing change.
Okay, go ahead, Mike. You go.
with Department of Building and Neighborhood Services as recommended.
All right, second.
Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Now, about the other part of it, what would be the way to?
I think we would just capture it in a budget amendment and just bring it through.
Yes.
Okay, okay, so you have to.
This gives us enough direction to start the process on the personnel side, and then we'll capture it on the financial side within our normal budget.
Okay, so really, really all we need to do is just recommend this to the board.
Yeah.
That's it, okay.
So number five is the review of the hotel motel tax fund.
This is really somewhat informational, but it came up when we were looking at the Harlandsdale Barn project. And I wanted to just highlight it for the committee's attention, something we had projected out with finances help in terms of a five-year outlook of that hotel motel tax. And as we've discussed, the conference center debt rolls off at the end of this calendar year. That adds some capacity that will be generated in that fund. And one of the things I would highlight as an opportunity for us is to develop maybe a multi-year funding plan around this fund as we move forward in terms of the types of projects we would fund out of it. We're utilizing it in a couple of the capital projects already, but to really build a plan around this fund over time. I think one of the key areas we've looked at it from a general policy standpoint was this would be a good mechanism to fund specifically some of the parks improvements. And I think that still makes a lot of sense. But I'd like to see us develop a plan so that we don't just, I guess, run to this periodically when we have something, that it still fits into a broader multi-year plan as we do with most of our other larger funds. So just wanted to highlight that for you. We've already anticipated a number for the Hayes home is nearing completion now, and the Harlandsdale barn stabilization, which you approved last night. So and in fact, I think that number is a little high from what you approved. I think you approved 670 and this is at 680 or something like that, so it's actually a little bit less. So I don't know, Russ and Mike worked on this projection. They can maybe highlight a little bit what's behind it. And it's really more to just get this in your mind and maybe we look at how we build this and especially work with maybe Lisa as we're looking at capital projects and what might fit into a five-year horizon with these kind of projections.
One of the things that we really wanted to do was to start taking some of these small funds and giving you and devoting some time to it in our committee meetings and letting you know what a five-year picture looks like. You know, just for your benefit, we assume the hotel taxes are going to grow at a rate of about 3% a year. That's inflation plus some additional rooms that may come on. We did go ahead and include the Drury rooms in this, but it's still uncertain what effect that they would have or other hotels would have on the room rates and what the market conditions would do. So when you look at those out years, we did plug in a 3% growth for that. The profit from the conference center, we assumed 2% growth, strictly inflation, that there would not be a tremendous amount of growth, but that they would continue to operate and provide these funds to us. This amount is our half of the proceeds from the conference center portion of the building alone. The county is getting an equal amount. I would point out to you that the contract for the management of this comes up in 2014. We've talked about that. So we've assumed that contract will be renewed in some form and go on in roughly the same condition that it is now. The other item that I would mention is the very last one, the Convention and Visitors Bureau. Because of the growth in the hotel tax, again, we plugged in a factor for growth in that amount. So as you see those numbers go up year to year, you know, we've tried to coordinate that with the hotel motel taxes.
And that coordinates with that 1% that we've been allocating to the CVB. The other thing that's in here, kind of two-thirds down the page, you see some debt service notes. we did assign a component of the streetscape projects to hotel motel, specifically the elements that are more along the lines of beautification for these kind of key commercial corridors, felt that was appropriate. So those have been assigned. We anticipate a portion of assignment of this from Hillsborough to this as well. Again, those the sort of beautification elements, that those are eligible and appropriate to assign here.
Third Avenue as well?
Not huge debt service. Do we have a little Third Avenue?
Yeah, Third Avenue.
Yeah, that's part of this one. We've already issued the...
And Columbia.
Yeah, Columbia's in here.
All three of those projects.
And Third Avenue is one that we've just awarded, but it was anticipated with the one, I think, the $44 million as the Build America. It's folded into that. And actually, the Hillsborough portion is really already...
It's already accounted for here. And it's important that you know that we have, without knowing what the bids are going to be like, we've elected to put in 35% of the debt service as streetscape, cosmetic, landscaping, the proportion that would be in here. If that happens to come in less, then this number would actually go down. So we've taken an overly conservative approach, if you will. Until we actually bid those out, particularly the Hillsborough, we're not going to know what the
with Columbia
drainage,
we did that calculation.
The drainage elements in
that's
that.
That's right, because stormwater will be a part
because stormwater there. Will come into play there. So we've kind of taken and perhaps a little more aggressive approach in saying fully a third of all of the debt services.
But wait, keep in mind, from 96 up to Del Rio, that will be a big proportion of it. Now, from Del Rio on up to Matt Catcher, it will not so much because there will actually be street improvements.
Right.
Whereas the part that's from 96 to Del Rio is not going to really have any street
as a relative share.
Right.
It changes a little bit as you get up there. Yeah,
absolutely.
That's true.
So that's the caveat I would give you. You know, we think that we have included a sufficient amount to account for what that debt service will be. But, you know, until we get there...
It's not going to be more than this,
no,
probably. It's
no.
Be safe to say. This is a conservative number based on what we think would be probably the high end of that share. It might be a little bit less.
Could be.
Yeah. So that it's not a huge number, but it adds up. It helps with those projects as well.
It does indeed.
And we've tried to source those projects out to the appropriate elements because you've got stormwater, you got water and sewer improvements, and of course the major portion being the street improvements as well.
Well, two things we haven't said. The big one is that we're going to pay off the conference center debt.
Yeah, I want to know about that one.
That's the first thing.
What's that?
And the other thing is that unlike the road impact fees and the facilities tax, which are by law restricted to certain uses, this is technically not restricted to specific uses.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, on those other things, you must spend it
on those,
on certain things, and as I say, you can't just spend it anywhere. This you really can spend anywhere. Hmm. I know the idea has been, practice has been that we would use it for, parks and
things that had sort of tourist related expenditure, thus the CVB allocation and the others.
Yes,
it's a way to put money back into what generates the hotel motel tax, which is visitor tourism, meeting expenses,
and things that
help make the community an attractive place to visit
I think the Convention and Visitor Bureau absolutely has to do with tourism.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not positive that some of this other stuff has anything to do with tourism.
Like,
for instance, the Third Avenue North here, I don't think that has anything to do with tourism.
Mm.
But at any rate, I'm just saying that's been the practice, but keep in mind that really it is not, you know, it is not, there's no requirement that they be spent for that.
I noticed that we've got a notation for debt service on the Eastern Flank Battlefield, but when do we commit the dollars for the Loop Road that have been set aside?
That's a good question.
Yeah. You know, I think that's in the projects. It's included in the debt service, but I'll go back and check.
But we talked about it coming out.
I think
we may already have done that. I would point out.
That's been on the books for.
If you notice.
Let's see how we've been that.
We were asked last night about how much was left outstanding on the eastern flank, on our portion of that purchase. And you can see we're only paying $200,000 a year on that because it's spread out over a number of years. Mm-hmm. So you can imagine this is the debt service on $2.5 million. The debt service on the loop road is not going to be a number that's going to dramatically affect that.
You could almost just pay that off, just like you were talking about paying the barn off.
I think when we did the funding plan, we sort of looked at that as a you could go either way.
Yeah, exactly.
I think we, for debt service calculations, we folded it in as a maximum debt. But I think you're right. My recommendation would be we probably look at paying that as a pay-as-you-go kind of thing, which we've had a little more of a history of doing that here as we did with the Harlan Sale project.
Yeah.
So
that's
given where we are, we'll judge that, but I think that's likely to be the way we...
Just paying for the road outright.
Yes.
It's just going to be $300,000.
I know.
Just pay for it.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't put it into debt service. That probably, exactly. I like that idea very much.
Mm-hmm. Sure, I check for it.
Yeah.
Yeah, just pay for it instead of putting it in your debt.
Because if you look, this has a pretty nice fund balance compared to, you know,
some other things
that are still in deficit. So yeah, I think that would be a good idea. So,
I was just going to say, if you do like this format, we can do this with other funds as well, because we knew we wanted to go ahead and show 5 years, so we can do it for other funds as well.
Although, you need to say 2016 instead of 15 twice.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's just stupid.
We figure that'll be a particular...
Well, makes you worry. Should they get the years wrong with some of these numbers, type those to you?
Well, under the conference center, it says 515 and 552 there. Mm-hmm. I thought we were done by the end of 2012.
Well, that's in this fiscal year.
12 is fiscal 13.
Because that first, it's actually, we're actually giving you 4 years in this projection because you've got an actual.
Because we're done at the end of the year.
And that estimate is this current fiscal year.
We don't owe another penny off the end. Yeah, right. Okay, good.
Yeah, so that's reflective of this calendar year.
That's my favorite, but I thought, well.
But it's still in fiscal 13.
You were right.
Yeah.
But now, at some point, you know, they were talking to us about making improvements on they kind of backed off from that?
Well, I think you would look at that separately.
Yeah.
You know, there was a lot of talk about it. We did a feasibility study on that. At some point, there'll have to be an expansion or we'll lose our competitiveness against other conference centers.
Yeah, we will.
However, the collapse in 2008 and 2009, put that in rough balls for a while. So, you know, I think that it will come up again. And that's a lot of the reason why we wanted to get to this kind of long-range picture, because we know there are a lot of comments and designs potentially on the funds that are here. And you need to know what's there so you can make good decisions.
Right, you do.
Okay, well, this was a good overview. Do you have any other comments?
So the big jump in estimated in revenue is that pretty much the Drury or?
Yes,
in this year.
Because it's almost $400,000, but it's not that much.
If I remember right, it's the Marriott's 300 rooms. Drury is like 345. So there are a lot of rooms where we don't know is their vacancy rate, their price point. So we pretty much folded in about half of the revenue that the Marriott would get. Even though there are more rooms, we figure it will take them a while to build up their business.
Plus the price point's less.
And we've been experiencing a higher growth rate than that in the past couple years.
Yes.
But we wanted to stay more with just sort of an inflationary track.
Yeah.
And just factor in a little bit the additional room inventory on a fairly conservative basis.
Because that might cannibalize some of
it. You know that's going to happen
somewhat.
Yes.
Pops up here a bit more. Okay.
Okay, any other comments? No, we don't have to do anything about this.
No, I just wanted to give you that.
This was very helpful.
Food for thought.
As
we see things come forward, this is something we'll work on with the capital and investment program, as well as how these might fit into a 5-year outlook into that, into this fund.
Yeah.
Oh, we got this here. Okay, and then item six, that's the thing that came last night. I think we're just going to have to kind of look at this a little bit, but I think
It's a pretty high-level overview that Mark's going to present to you.
I know, I got it left at home.
And it's just really to kind of set the stage for when we present the cost of service data coming. So it just gives you a little bit of background and gets maybe a couple things for you to start thinking about in terms of things.
Lynne, I stole pearls out of her mailbox. You might want to put one back in her mailbox. Here's the cover sheet.
Yes, it is.
This is one side.
Okay. All right.
Mark, take it away.
I'll put it back.
Put it back.
Well, as Eric had said, this is really to get the discussion going. We're not looking for you all to make decisions tonight about things, but I wanted to get a discussion going. The slide that's up on the screen right now goes through a number of different discussion points that that I hope we can talk about this evening prior to going into the board work session in October and having a presentation with our consultant and moving forward.
Is Zach a part of this? Because he always likes to build in a lot of money. And
no,
so
he is not a part of the cost of service.
I want to say to you, I got this last night. I have kind of skimmed through. That is all I have done.
There's really no specific proposals in this at this point.
But I have read it carefully.
Yeah, we're looking to bring forward and have the consultant with us at the work session on October 9th to give an overview of his cost of service study,
right,
and where we are at that point. And this really just sort of lays the ground for work for where we're going,
right,
and kind of some history of how we have performed and where we are. And so we can let Mark kind of take you through this and give you a chance to think about it a little bit.
Okay. Thank you. But yes, wanted to kind of discuss where we are in our five-year financial plan. We've gone through a series of three rate adjustments starting in January of 2010. Discuss the integrated planning projects briefly as a point that they are going to be considerations for everyone coming up here in the near future. And then discuss a few items regarding water rate design and sanitary sewer rate design. If you go into the next slide, this was one of the graphs that we had presented back in, I think it was 2010, and it shows where we were in terms of recovery on the water side. In 2008, we were at about 88% recovery. Actually, in 2010, when we started implementing the five-year financial plan, we were closer to about 85 to 86%. If you go to the next slide.
Mark, what does that mean?
Yes.
Number one is that if you look, the residential out was about 50% more than the residential inside. Mm-hmm. And for many years, that is what mm-hmm. the board at the time said we wanted. It didn't have anything to do
right.
with the cost,
right.
the cost of it. So whenever you're talking about recovery, you're talking about recovery of cost.
Correct.
But there was a policy basically
yeah.
back then
mm-hmm.
that the outside would pay about 50% more
mm-hmm.
per account.
She's talking about
outside.
That's actually one of the discussion points yeah. that I'm hoping to get input from y'all tonight.
That's right.
What direction do we want to go in? So
because it's not just, mm-hmm. and I noticed you said in here,
mm-hmm.
part of it is that there's a because the actually totally at the very end, the full faith and credit of the city
mm-hmm.
is in play here, although generally not because it's a fund that's supposed to pay for itself.
Mm-hmm.
But still, there is something about the difference between giving the service
yeah.
providing mm-hmm. the service to people outside the city limits compared to providing it to people inside
yeah.
the city limits.
Yep.
Mark, go ahead and explain cost recovery, what
yeah.
that means
okay.
exactly.
Yeah, because I was thinking this is the water that we were going to recycle, reclaim.
My apologies.
Different kind of recovery.
I like to use money mode yeah. because I'm not
yes,
there.
Sir. I'm sorry. So cost recovery is
we recover
the monies that it costs us to operate, essentially, in the operations side, not access, tap fees. This is solely operation and maintenance of our system. So when we're at 88% recovery, The revenues we receive can only fund 88% of what we are required to spend in operations.
What it costs us to run the utility.
MNO.
So, pardon me?
MNO.
MNO?
Isn't it O&M?
O&M?
Oh, I was sorry.
Operations.
No.
Either way, it's, yes.
Yeah, O&M, I knew our measure.
Sure.
O&M, operations and management.
Yeah.
So. That's only where you're talking.
Yeah, and like, as I said, I have a presentation here, and, you know, by no means.
Others be quiet, let me finish?
No.
Well,
I mean, if you want to go that route too, that's your priority. No, but.
But compare this one to the next one.
The next slide is where you see where we are now.
So we're at 93% recovery currently. And again, we're at the end of three rate adjustments. We're doing better than we anticipated originally, which is good news.
Move this slide.
You gotta go to the next slide.
Oh, sorry, my apologies.
See, this is current.
Yes, ma'am.
This is where we are now, right?
About what it is, when it is.
Yeah, yeah.
So this is current right now?
Victoria, yes.
Current cost.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
But I know what you mean. I just kinda skimmed through this at least.
I know, it's rate class.
So when you flip back to that, you look at 86, we're at, or 2006, we're at 86% recovery. 2008, we're at 88% recovery. You look at where we are today at about 93% recovery.
Right.
But also compare residential in and residential out.
Correct.
Now they're not paying 50% more. Mm-hmm. They're paying, maybe 30.
Yeah, 28%.
Yes. But I'm just mm-hmm. saying that's one of the things that,
right.
that we're talking about.
What supplements the 7%?
Pardon me?
What supplements the fact that we're 7% shy?
Really, what we the monies that we don't spend, essentially. So if you go out and you look at rate-funded capital projects, replacement or rehabilitation of existing lines, you can push off those type of projects or those types of activities. You know, that's eventually it's going to come back around, and you're going to be faced with, you know, potentially huge problems and then of course huge price tags associated.
We're not maintaining and replacing
at the rate we should.
All right, Joe wasn't with the streets and we had to finally go, okay, we got to give you some money.
It's a lot like that. We're not in a deficit position in here, but we're not spending dollars that we have looked at and say we need to spend on an annual basis to maintain a system of the size and age that we operate.
Right.
But is part of this because we decided not to do the full rate increase and spread it out over multiple years? Does that have any play in?
I think that does have some play, but you know, if we look, say back in 2010 when we started this plan, we said let's pull the trigger on it, all of it right now, then that rate increase would have been X. As we've gone over these few years, you'll have some increase in cost because of inflation, inflationary costs, things of that nature. Fuel prices go up, chemical costs go up. So, you know, in doing it over a period of time, you have to also build into the rate increases or rate adjustments additional costs as time presses on. So, you know, you can. Ultimately, we need to recover what the system requires us to do with it. And, you know, and we're making a great deal of progress. The plan seems to be working well, but we do have, you know, as we have these big decisions to make in the future with the integrated planning projects, whether it's the wastewater treatment plant expansion, water distribution projects, water treatment projects. So all that comes into play, and we'll talk about that briefly. So.
And what the board did is decided to make that more manageable over multiple mm-hmm. years, and right. we've adjusted the budget to sort of reflect that as well. So, you know, we have made good, steady progress, and that was the direction that we charted out a few years ago, and that's what we keep working on.
So. Right, right. If we go to the next slide, it's the sanitary sewer recovery by rate class. The 2008 number shows 85% at the time of which we implemented our financial plan, it was in the low 80s. If you go to the next slide, however, you can see where we are currently.
100%?
Yes, and that's based on this year's projected operations and maintenance costs.
Yeah.
I think that's wonderful, but I also want to highlight that there are considerations here that we need to discuss. So. But yeah, so just take a moment if you have questions, let me know.
Surely the residential allowed is only 25% more than the residential in.
Yes.
And I want to comment on that just a little bit, because we're trying, you know, you, there's a room for policy direction by the board in terms of that difference.
Right.
But there's also guidance that we've received that we need to still be tying to the true cost of providing the service. And so we've got to find that right balance, that we are reflective of the cost of operating and providing the service, as well as what is the benefit that is appropriate to allocate to those non-residents that they're getting through the use of our expertise, the backing of our full faith and credit of the city, et cetera. So it absolutely justified in differentiating. We need to be careful about how much we differentiate, and that it's got a basis that we can defend in terms of cost structure.
Right. As a citizen, you know, I would want this body to acknowledge that being a citizen, my dollars are going towards the financial backing of the city, and you know, the people who are not part of the city, who don't live within the city, are getting a benefit that I'm not getting necessarily. I'm paying for the benefit they're not. So, you know, I would want this body to acknowledge that. But to balance that, you know, if there is a policy decision that could or should be made, arguably. I think it's important to remember that when you look at cost of service, while we don't necessarily have to go strictly with cost of service, it has to have some form of justification. And there's, you know, communities across the state, across the country, have they widely varying degrees in which they have an inside versus an outside rate. You know, advice that we've received from our consultant is that it needs to be within reason. To get a specific number, you know, that's hard to do. But, you know, to say that outside is going to pay 300% more than inside, you know, I think we would be faced with problems. You know, so I'm just using it as an example. Another thing to remember, too, is that while I, as a citizen, want this, you know, the city to acknowledge that they are not paying for that financial backing. I'll just use that as the example. The number of customers that are outside the city limits are fairly limited. So if you increase their rates considerably, the revenues that we get from it is not necessarily significant. So again, it all goes back to balance. And we can talk about that here very shortly. So
there's clearly room for you to have policy discretion on that. There's just a counterbalance in looking at what that measure reasonable is, and mm-hmm. and the cost of service always runs in the background of any of these rate discussions as well. So,
well, also I'm noticing on sewer, you know, that's really where we are. Now, let me ask you this. Here's a question. All these sewer recovery by rate class,
mm-hmm.
inside the city limits and outside, it doesn't just mean served by the Franklin Water.
No, ma'am.
No. Outside of the city limits.
Inside the city.
Correct.
And outside the city.
Right. So we have four utilities that contribute.
So, but I mean, how many commercial outside the city limits?
Grassland's an area. There's an area in Brentwood.
Commercial?
It's, yeah, Brentwood. Yep.
Yeah, you've got a few.
Yeah, north of Moore's Lane, there's some commercial areas.
South of Moore's Lane down Crossroads.
That's right.
A little bit right in there.
Mm-hmm. And then Grassland area, I think, are the primary commercial areas.
One.
Oh, no, I'm sorry.
North of
Moore's Lane. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry, I'm stuck on water. Yeah. So
down by Crossroads Boulevard, mm-hmm. in that way.
Right, there's a
yep.
a hook that, as Steve
that's
described.
That's in Brentwood.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. And then Grassland.
I was thinking of water.
No, grass and sewer.
Correct.
Well, but those are little commercial. That little commercial.
There's a residential area in Grassland, the Meadow Green area. But as far
Meadow Green's the residential, but there's not any commercial.
Yeah.
That's not ours.
No, they had those down. I'm starting.
Barry's Chapel Church is not.
That's not.
It's outside.
But we have an agreement with them at Grassland.
That Cool Springs.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, we have an agreement with the county.
So, let's see, there's, this doesn't look like.
That's what we have.
Is that what you have?
Water projects first.
Okay. Now, I put this table in here, and I want to briefly talk about this slide and the next slide. The board is asked to proceed with going for statements of qualifications for design firms for a number of projects. These are included in here, as well as some of that we've talked about, but I think this is more, I want these, put these tables in here just so we remember to consider these when, you know, a number of these projects are going to be funded by either rates or system development fees, those fees that are associated by the monies we receive from our customers. That's really the only. Yes, ma'am.
If that covers 50% of it, if that money that we get from development, from developers covers 50% of this.
Yeah.
Because the last thing that I heard was, that would be the amount that could be attributed to the.
Are you looking at percent growth?
That much money might not come in.
Yeah. Well, you're referring to the 50% and the percent growth, correct?
Yeah.
Now, that number and every number in that column is going to be based on decisions that you all make. This is merely in here for sake of conversation. These are not numbers that we're going to attribute to the user fees, necessarily.
Right.
This is just, you know,
but that would be something like, whenever they get new tap fees and stuff like that.
Right.
You could allocate those costs.
You could allocate that.
Correct.
But you don't think we're going to get $2 million in tap fees? I don't know. In our water? I don't think so.
Well, so you look at these projects and the sanitary sewer projects, we also have some additional considerations as well, which is our impact fee study, which we're going through at this point right now.
And let's go back just for a moment just to say, on the water projects, we have okayed the design only for the increase to the 4 million gallons per day. But the upgrade of the water treatment plant, that stuff that we have to do to keep it going.
Yeah, you and that's what that refers to. We've been given a green light on three of those projects. We're moving full speed ahead in terms of the design will take place, and we're getting near coming to you with a recommendation on those design consultants and on the water plant expansion. Yeah, that is only a preliminary design that will be used to help us facilitate a decision on whether to expand that plant or not.
So that's not a full design?
I think it's just a preliminary.
We had discussed going through a preliminary design, I think mostly to define costs and also to ensure that the layout of the upgrade can accommodate an expansion in the future if this board or a board in the future chooses to do so. So I think that's why we ended up going in that direction initially. We didn't want to kind of, you know, pigeonhole us into a 2 MGD plant by not considering what an expansion might look
like.
But
there's a lot to all this. That's a very complex.
Yes, ma'am.
Question though, the
issue.
This preliminary design, it does not have a cost of $4 million.
That's the cost, total construction.
Estimated cost of the improvement.
So design is just the status.
Correct. Yeah, that's the status.
Yeah, that's what you told us to do. Yeah.
Correct. That is where we are in terms of our interaction with you all.
It's around $8 million, it looks like so far. I have no idea if that's.
The upgrade and expansion is about 9 and 9.8, somewhere in that neighborhood. So, anyways, these slides are in here just as a reminder that while we are making great strides in our 5-year financial plan, that these are going to quickly become a consideration for us. As I mentioned briefly a few moments ago, we are also looking at an impact fee study, and Alderman Peterson, referred to, are we going to be able to recapture the cost and access fees and SDF fees and those sorts of things. We're looking at bringing this to you probably starting in the end of October or in November, once we kind of make headway in this process. Also, as you know, about two-thirds of our water on average is supplied by Harpeth Valley. We do keep a close eye on them and their expansions, and is there going to be potential for rate increases through them? Because, you know, if Harpeth Valley has a rate increase towards us, we certainly need to capture those costs as well. So just another consideration.
While we're talking about that, they're still not enforcing that we come up with a minimum per month.
Yes, they are.
They've always done that.
And if we go over the maximum?
If we go over...
What is the rate, or does the rate increase, or over that minimum?
If we go over the maximum...
I mean the minimum.
The minimum, or go under the minimum? I'm sorry, I'm lost very quick.
There's a difference. We set a maximum amount that we're going to purchase.
Correct.
And if we go over that, they charge us.
They charge us the same rate as we get charged currently. They've never exercised any provisions, though. I think we stay within the limits or the projections that we provide to them. We provide five-year projections every year, so.
Okay.
So we tell them...
How about the minimal then?
We're going to use at least this much, and
correct.
Sometimes it may be this much. And so far, we've always...
We're going to pay whether we use it or not.
We provide a daily max and a month max, and they have essentially a calculation that they do to come up with our minimum charge, is how that is, or minimum consumption. So that's how that works.
Mark, do we ever purchase less than that minimum number?
There have been times in which we have, yes. But we continually look at, you know, we want to make sure that we purchase our minimum. So sometimes we'll ramp the plant down and buy more water if our demands are considerably low.
Paying it anyway.
Right, yeah, so we might as well buy the water from them. So, yes.
I think that's reasonable, though.
Mm-hmm.
Really.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. No, yes, absolutely.
Last week, volleyball. I got to move on.
Good luck.
Do we have any action? Well, let's see. Leader
vote. Okay. Well, if we could...
There's no action.
Let's bring this back.
Mark, you had me, but sorry.
So, volleyball, I understand.
But, you know, the winter pricing and stuff like that and the Metro Rose.
This is one we want to kind of have you think a little bit about, explain. Let's have Mark kind of explain those ideas. This is a question we've gotten from time to time from folks about irrigation, and is there a better way to do irrigation rates to reflect that? And that's something we've asked the consultant with us to take a look at and sort of do a pro and con on some of those approaches.
So. Yeah, and there, you know, I'm not looking for votes or decisions, but you know, it's really to get you all thinking about these different concepts. The customer charge, as you know, and I'm going to go to the next slide real quickly. This is our current rate structure, the table on the top. You can see our availability charge or customer charge. I apologize, I didn't change that. I think it was from an old table, but we have gone from a customer charge. Sorry, pull this out. In 2010, of $7.22 is the customer charge. So our current is $10.42. We have bumped up the incremental rates as well one time during the past 3 years. But the focus has been always on this customer charge, and that's really, you know, and as you look at the bullets on the water rate design slide, that helps us to recover the fixed costs that are due to capacity, our customer service, our billing that happens in metering. As a byproduct of focusing on this customer charge, it does provide a degree of stabilization in our rates. Every bill that we send out, we get that customer charge. One of the concepts we're looking at, utility billing, revenue management are looking at, is the concept of e-billing. And this is not a consideration for the board here, but I wanted to put this out here, is that customer service charge that's associated with sending out a bill to your home every month, there's a cost associated with it, whether it's, you know, between $3 and $5. I don't know what the number is, but you know, if we choose to go to e-billing, do we want to provide, you know, some
benefit to the people who choose that. It saves us money. It saves them money. Yeah. So it's just a consideration. And then, as of course...
We would not ever be able to go to it
completely. Pardon me?
We would never be able to go to it completely.
You're probably still going to have some folks.
Right. Absolutely.
But it also, there's a benefit to us not only in the cost savings, but it's also by getting that email, we provide another way to communicate with customers and to work with them, not only just on bills, but also any other communication we have related to the system, et cetera. So it is a benefit to us the more we can use it.
Well, listen, yes, if it's $3 a month, then the cost of service for the minimum ought to go down.
Well, exactly. So if we have customers who choose to go e-billing, then do they get a break on their bill by some?
It's a thought.
So it's a thought. The next main bullet here is inside versus outside city rates, and we've touched on this briefly. Again, I don't know if you all have independently in your heads what you'd like to see. Apparently, thank you, Bev. Apparently, years ago, there had been, and I don't know if it was a formal policy or if it had been a kind of an unspoken policy, that is 150% is what I've heard.
I think it used to be that.
So, the way that we bill right now, we have an inclining rate structure in water and we have declining in sewer. So to go precisely 150% over or some number over, you can't really do anymore because of the... But, if we can maybe set a policy that, the average customer may, so whatever it may be. Anyway, it's just something that we need to consider, and if you'd like us to design the rates to head in that direction, we can certainly do so. As you can see on...
Well, whatever, when we're increasing, we can tweak it all those times.
Right. So, the sewer right now, the residential inside's at 95%. Residential outside's 121%. So you're at about, 26%. More. We can make those adjustments. But it's just something that I want you all to be thinking about as we step into the discussion in October. Right now, we have an inclining rate structure in the water side. This is intended to capture costs that are associated with those really large demands that we have generally associated with irrigation. And then the last main bullet on this water rate design is the irrigation meter water rates. This is going to tie into our sanitary sewer rate design discussion as well. So I'm going to leave that. I'm going to make the statement and then head down to the sanitary sewer rate design discussion, but circle back to the...
Why don't we come back and do an irrigation discussion?
I think the
ideas and options around irrigation.
Right, so we'll have to circle back on that because they're somewhat, they are interrelated. The next slide is our sanitary sewer rate design. or considerations for sanitary sewer rate design. Again, the customer charge. Like water, it recovers fixed costs due to capacity and customer service and billing. It does, as you increase that customer charge, the byproduct is stabilization of rates, and again, back to the discussion with e-billing. Again, this is something that y'all would need to or possibly consider in terms of inside versus outside city rates. Do you want to set a specific number? We'll dig into that.
And how we said that the highest irrigation use is really outside the city for a residential outside the city? I mean, if you're talking about, I think once I heard that the large summer
larger irrigators are
irrigators were outside the city limits.
Who have a separate irrigation meter.
Okay.
And that's important. We only have 125 or so customers who have purchased a separate irrigation meter.
Right.
About half are inside, half outside. And the big swingers are outside the city.
That's right. The big users, yeah.
And so that, then we, the last main bullet on the sanitary sewer rate design, we enter in the irrigation discussion. I know there's been...
Right now, it's not, I mean, it is an incentive, but it's not huge, because I had one of the customers say to me, it'd take at least 10 years for them to...
To pay it off.
That's one of the things we're...
Right. Our current rates for a 3/4-inch irrigation meter is a, I'm not going to give you the exact, I'm not going to know the exact, it's about $3,800 to install one. Right now, in the way that we acknowledge irrigation use on a standard meter or delivery point, is that we have a declining rate structure on the sewer side. So what that does is, you know, as your water consumption goes up, your sewer rate goes down. And we also provide for a separate irrigation meter, but as you said, the cost to install one can be prohibitive in many cases. There are a number of different ways in dealing with this. Metro Water Services in Brentwood, I put in the presentation what they do. They do a winter pricing structure. In the city of Franklin, though, that becomes a bit of a challenge. We have four utilities, water utilities. So when you look at applying a winter pricing structure to four utilities, it becomes very cumbersome. They have different pricing policies, a number of other things that would make it a challenge. One of the other considerations would be to incentivize the installation of irrigation meters. So drop that price point on the installation of the irrigation meter. And those customers who are debating whether or not to go to a specific irrigation meter, it would become more accessible to them. And their return would be quicker. Right now, you know, as I said, we're about, it's between $3,500 and $4,000. You know, we could certainly come up with a number to cover our cost to install an irrigation meter. It'll be a fraction of the current cost, but it would get those people onto an irrigation system, and they wouldn't be paying the sewer fees associated with their consumption.
The other side to that, though, is when they use the irrigation is whenever we're also having to buy all of our water, just about. And I very well remember, what was it, 2006 or 2007?
Seven, yes.
They had the water people go out and turn and lock all of those irrigation meters.
Right.
So that would be a disincentive, I think.
That's one of the things. Yeah. Yes, we do better when we sell more water. We're talking about sewer now, but let's just talk about irrigation and water. But, and yet, when these instances come up where there's an issue, you know, then if we promoted that you should be irrigating, and that's where we have to step in, because that's where...
Yeah, I don't
that's
necessarily...
That's a non-essential.
Yeah, I don't necessarily view us
where
incentivizing...
Where does the conservation come in?
I don't view incentivizing an irrigation meter as promoting irrigation. You know, what it does is provide them an alternative to paying that high sewer bill. If we circle back to the water rate design slide.
Well, but if we're producing water, it doesn't matter if it's going in your house or it's going on your lawn.
It depends.
We're still
That's a social question.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Depends what the price is.
Yeah.
Well, I think that, you know, didn't it say in here that our water, where did I see that and I don't, it may not have been in here, that the water usage was down like 13% or something? And
purchases.
Our water purchases. Well, that's...
Yeah, our purchases.
However, though, that's also... you were saying that had to do with the reservoir. But the thing is that I know people who got the $300 plus bills back in whenever, and they made a conscious decision they weren't going to do that anymore.
Right. We've seen an increase in consumption. If you recall talking about the budget amendment. I don't recall the numbers off the top of my head, but between 5% and 10%, we're starting to see consumption pick back up.
Well, I knew we had. I knew we had one kind.
So yeah, I think that's a reason why we're reaching recovery more quickly than originally anticipated. A reason, number of others also, but so if we end up going to or incentivizing an irrigation meter. you know, in times of emergency, it does provide us better control of the system if we choose to do that. I don't want to use that as the driver to go to an irrigation meter. But it, in circling back to the water rate design slide, would the city consider an irrigation meter rate separate from that of a domestic water rate? You know, right now we essentially do that by the inclining rate structure. We have, you know, that first block of 10,000 gallons is X rate, and then the block after that is X plus some number rate. So you look at that, and so we do have somewhat built into our rate structure an irrigation rate. If we choose to go to an irrigation meter, incentivizing irrigation meters, right now we have, I think it's 250 residential and commercial irrigation-only meters. You know, if we end up with 3,000, do we want to consider a separate rate?
The thing is, though, they get the break on not having to pay the sewer.
They do get the break on not having to pay the sewer.
Yeah, that's the key right there.
I mean, that's the reason they do it.
Right. And I'm glad you brought that up because I was getting there eventually. Yeah. Sorry, this is a long-winded discussion. But if we do incentivize an irrigation meter, or if we do go to a winter pricing structure, that will impact our wastewater revenues. And as you impact the wastewater revenues, you're going to have to consider possibly raising rates again. So those customers who do irrigate and pay the sanitary sewer bill is associated with that irrigation is essentially subsidizing the cost of our wastewater collection and treatment presently. As we move away from that, the revenues in wastewater is going to go down. We maintain rates as they are, so you would have to consider raising rates in order to fill the gap, essentially. So, anyway, you know, go ahead.
I was just going to kind of cut to what I think, where I think we're, as we think about it, where we're headed is if the board wants to change the approach in terms of how we handle this type of situation, especially as it relates to irrigation, that probably reducing that cost of the irrigation meter to something a little more affordable, reflective of the cost still, but a little more affordable to folks, is probably the best way to do it, because you facilitate a true measure of what's being used for that purpose, as opposed to sort of backing into it through these other calculations that some of the other utilities do, plus the complexity that we have of multiple different water providers who all have a different, slightly different philosophy about how they handle irrigation. Mm-hmm. So if we move in that direction, then we're really doing it based on truly how much people are irrigating. Mark mentioned it does provide a greater control within the system about that, and understanding about that, about how that's being used, that water's being used for that purpose.
Right.
And then we would have to then structure our rates going forward accordingly. We still got to recover the cost, mm-hmm, on both sides of the house, both on the water side and the sewer, sanitary sewer side. So I think as we think about it, that's probably the if you wanted to change our approach, that would probably be the one that we would look at as probably the best way to go down that path if you wanted to, and make that a little more reflective of the cost. Right now there's sort of this artificial premium built into that.
But then again, that really, you know, you've got to balance. I mean, the water. I mean, you know, if it's, yep, being, mm-hmm, if the water is being treated, which we're talking about here,
yes,
we're not talking about the entities that have the reclaimed water.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm, so, you know, it's costing just as much to.
It does.
And to get that water to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if you do incentivize the irrigation meter, for example, and they're not paying that sanitary sewer bill, it's possible that they'd be more inclined to use more water, which, you know, lends to higher capacity costs and things of that nature. So that
still have your inclining rate.
Yeah,
and even when you look at your inclining rate, or as Mark said, you could even have an irrigation rate.
Right. Enter the discussion of possibly an irrigation.
Well, and that would only be on the water side. I mean, it would be.
Right.
How many of these current big separate irrigation meters would be enough capacity that we would consider the reclaimed water?
Are there opportunities in that?
Reclaimed water is also, you know, a limited resource. This year we saw demands over 5 million gallons a day. And as you know, when summer comes along and the groundwater tables go down and you have reduced inflow and infiltration, the flow through the plant reduces. So we start approaching the plant flows, you know, so, you know, so that too is a balance. The reclaimed water is not, you know, that's something we watch closely, and that's why we had the discussion a month or so ago regarding, you know, we need to have these information from potential customers so we can manage it. So, you know, the reclaimed water, the way the current rate is, it's 97 cents per 1,000 gallons. And generally speaking, it's non-residential customers. At that rate, to maintain the smaller infrastructure to serve residential properties, your costs really go up. You know, and
I'm not so much talking about residential, but there are other big
golf courses, LoJack, the quarries and things like that.
And he's addressing those. The expansion along Downs picked up the other big ones available and Forest Crossing, and they're working through that one.
Right. Yeah, the expansions that we've done in the reclaim system were, there was, the idea was to, we identified potentially large users to pull them off the potable system. So that's the driver to get those pipes in the ground in those areas. So thank you, Steve.
Then there's a lot to think about here.
There is. But I apologize. I didn't want to, you know, scare you all into thinking there's a decision coming. But I wanted to get the conversation going. You know, I'd happy to, you know, I don't know what time it is now, but I'd be happy to stick around and discuss whatever you'd like. Otherwise, we can sit back down on the 9th. I think it's the 9th, and continue our discussion.
So we'll have another session.
We were going to bring to the work session on the 9th the kind of a first presentation of the cost of service study that they've been working on, and it would just, you know, it would be the update that includes where we are now and any potential direction on rates. The other thing I'd like, and that I'll probably bring up then, that I'd like the board to start thinking about is the potential of doing a multi-year rate structure. 2 or 3 years, we would revisit it every year, but we would always have 2 or 3 years on the books, so that we're always working on that, and we may adjust those future increases up or down based on where we are. But I've done that in a couple other situations, and it's very helpful to have that further outlook on your rates, just as we're doing planning for operational and capital expenses out beyond a year. You know, you still keep the discipline of reviewing your rates every year, but you keep an outlook that is beyond 1 year in terms of a rate structure.
Isn't that what we're doing right now, though? Didn't we say we would do this we've
charted a course, but we haven't adopted the rates. We're still adopting rates a year at a time. And so I guess what I'd ask you to think about is at least take maybe 2 years or 3 years outlook and adopt those, but then revisit them every year in a consistent period.
Isn't that the same thing? I mean, if you're going to revisit them every year,
Having them on the books is different than having a plan that you don't act on but a year at a time. Does that?
Well, we may want to talk about that.
Yeah,
it's
something to think about.
I'm not sure that the semantics to me, if you don't look at it.
Annual adjustments.
No. What I'm saying is that's what we're doing right now. We got this plan, and we look at it every. You're saying that we pass it every year, but if you revisit it every year, that's just like saying you can say yes or no on it every year, isn't it?
Well, you still have rates. You make a decision on whether you want to make any adjustment to those rates, but you actually have rates on the books for more than the immediate year.
So, in other words, you can't make a change in them.
You can if the board wants to, but you've also got more than 1 year already established. You've got a further horizon out there from a revenue planning standpoint on the.
I can't see any difference in doing and having planned ahead and then implementing it every year than saying that you have it and you're going to look at it every year, I mean, that you're going to have the potential to revise it every year. To me, that just seems, as I say, like semantics.
Internally, it may not, there may not be a difference to us around this table, but to the state revolving fund, from whom we are preparing to borrow a boatload of money to do some of these projects.
Well, if you were going to the bond market, the rating agencies, when they see multiple years of rates, that's something that is looked on very favorably.
Just a reminder that when we did some of the funding through the, like on the reservoir with the state revolving fund, they essentially put a gun to our head and said, you have to raise rates or we're not going to loan you the money, because at that point we were under recovering substantially. Now, we're in a better position right now than we were, as you saw with that 93% recovery, but it would mean a lot to them when they review our the loans that we're about to make if we had increases on the books going forward that are more or less locked in, unless you take action to change that. That clearly means a lot to them in the discussions that we've had with them. Is that not correct, Mark?
Right. Something to consider. We're not necessarily putting it on the table at this point, but it's something I'd like to throw out there for you to think about as we're doing these, especially as we have done right now. We've built a rate plan around a five-year horizon. We're right. Heading into year three, I guess, of that right. Five-year horizon.
We've done three adjustments.
Okay. So yes. That's kind of, you know, so just as we continue on that path, which I think is absolutely the right way to do, do we want to take it another step and actually adopt rates for maybe 2 years? It's something to think about.
Item seven is just talking about our reports at this point. The only thing I saw, what if we propose this year for to be the increase in the sales tax every year? Because I noticed this was just the very first one, and it was below.
Well, if I remember right, it was slightly under 4% based on the estimate that we had at the time we did the budget. Of course, in August, we finally got the June numbers. So the actual amount that we ended up with for the year was a little stronger than we anticipated. So we're, in round numbers, we estimated 4% of what we thought we would get last year, but it's about 3% more than we actually got last year.
Okay, so you're saying 4%.
We estimated 4, but we only got 3. Is that what you're saying?
No, we estimated 4% above the budget that we had last year. Actually, it was
the estimated
actual. But when the actual came in, it was a little above that.
Okay.
So why, if we got 4.1% more than last?
It's just 1 month.
I know, I understand that. But
it was off by a whisker.
No, but what I'm saying is, though, if that's 4.1% and we were expecting to have it 3% lower, but you're saying the totality?
No, 4% above what we thought we would get for the year is what we forecasted. That's 4% more than I think what we had for that 1 month, correct?
Right, right. Oh, yeah. Okay. It just seemed... And I guess the other things we would say is, you know, I'm not sure that I understand why, now that I think about it, on the Williamson County Facilities Tax, that's really only for residential, right? The Williamson County Facilities Tax, that only is applied to residential?
I think it's for both.
I thought it was for all.
Okay. Well,
remember, there's not a lot of commercial.
There's not much non-residential in the county.
But we get, I'm going to say 30% of that or
yes.
Whatever it is. Mm-hmm. So it's not really development in our, in the city. It's just that we get a certain percent of what they get for the whole county, right?
No, I think it's for what is done in the city. I'll go back and take a look at that.
So it's actual, not a percentage.
I thought in the documentation.
County
it
collection
said,
within the city, I thought. But.
Yeah.
Okay.
County collection within the city, but I think it's residential and non-residential.
Okay. But because, you know, our road impact fees are lower than we were expecting, and our facilities tax was lower than we were expecting. And this was higher than we were projecting.
That might mean, you know, I'm just making a comment. I don't know what, why or anything like that. I just thought that was interesting.
No, that, wait a minute, that Williamson County facilities tax, though, has to do with their share of what they were using for schools, right? I think, isn't that?
Well, they title the passage of that as a schools adequate facilities tax, mm-hmm. but I'm not sure it's restricted to schools.
Okay. Okay. But then they, but the state?
I think they elected to devote their portion to schools.
Okay, but what I'm trying to say is, though, they were required by the state to share a certain percentage of it with us.
By going to the maximum, they are required to do that.
Look at that, then. I guess since we only have two of us,
I hope those are.
I think we'll just say we will adjourn.
All right, thank you.